It's time to welcome back the Reverend Dr. Anna Madsen to talk about loving Christ for the sake of the world. And don't get worried if I go off the stage. I got to go hug my brother because he's mad at me now.
I'm more worried that you're going to not just use your crozier, but tell me to shut up and go sit down. And so
The people that I talk to at lunchtime are looking forward to you speaking this afternoon.
Thank you. All right, so we were with Capon and the Trinity. I've had a number of people ask where that quote came from, and it's from, I misquoted actually when I ran into somebody, I said hunting the divine fox, but that's not right. The third peacock, the problem of God and evil. You can find that passage that he wrote about the Trinity and the glories of creation. Robert Farrar Capon. Just as a quick aside, I ran into Capon the first time when I was at St. Olaf, not as a math major, but as an English major. With a minor in medieval women mystics, I graduated in 1991 and sold socks then for another year or so, but that, whatever. But the point is that the first time that I ran into Capon was in one of my English classes, because he not only was an astonishing theologian, but also a magnificent chef. And he wrote a gorgeous cookbook and wrote pages and pages about the glories of slicing an onion and the pressure of the water pushing the membranes out in an onion in a way so that you can't put the slices together again in the same way that you can, for example, an apple. And that was my introduction to Capon, who liked capons and cooked them well. All right, let's move back to the Trinity. We were talking about how the Trinity is relational. And one way of thinking about it is that within each of us, we have different roles and we bend into those different roles depending upon the people with whom we are, and yet those relationships bleed into then our engagements, our entanglements, so to speak, with others. And in the same way, the Trinity is deeply connected within itself, and yet we find different ways it expresses itself and yet engages with us, is affected by us, which in turn affects the Trinity's engagement. Let's see, I'm trying to find now where I was. Baseball. Did I mention the Twins? So it's baseball season. And we're therefore seeing the text everywhere, of course, in the baseball stadiums, being held on the placards. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. We were just talking about this, Kevin Strickland and I, yesterday. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. On rare occasions, I think I've seen it once, maybe twice, you see someone holding up a placard emblazoned only with John 3:17, not just 16, but John 3:17 says, indeed, God did not send the Son in the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be what? Saved through him. Okay, now the Greek word we translate here as saved is soteria. S-O-T-E-R-I-A, soteria. And it means in Greek health, healing, and wholeness. And so now with that in your mind, hear that John 3:17 again. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but for the sake of the world, that it might be healthy and healed and whole through him. That changes the tone. Not to mention the temporal gist of the passage, doesn't it? Suddenly the threat that people intentionally seek to inspire by highlighting verse 16 alone, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life, is less about what happens when you die and more about what the Trinitarian God hopes for the well-being of the world while we live. God as Trinity cares about the whole world now. God as Trinity wants the whole world now to experience salvation, to experience soteria, to experience health and healing and wholeness. Why? Because God is relational. Moreover, we are related to God, children, as it's oftentimes expressed in the scriptures. We are children of God, and in that way, we are quite literally embodied expressions of God. Where we go, what we do, how we treat people, for whom we vote, whether we comfort, whether we speak up and act, whether we abide the systems of oppression or turn them upside down, whatever we do as Christians is identified by others as what our God would do too. In short, you can get a sense of this Trinitarian God you see with this upshot. God creates with breath. God redeems from death. God yearns for health. Creation, sustenance, redemption, that's what our Trinitarian God is about. And moreover, if we call ourselves Christians, we align ourselves with that same Trinitarian agenda. We are ambassadors of it. Ambassadors of it all, breath, health, and resistance to all forms of unnecessary, offensive, life-taking forms of death. Enjoy. Do not forget the joy and the delight of the triune God. That is crazy but true. We who are gathered here, we are each ambassadors of the Trinitarian essence of soteria, of health and healing and wholeness and joy for all creation, for all creatures, for the sake of the world. And one last thing for the lecture that was supposed to have winded up earlier, you'll note that I used the word ambassador. And believe it or not, that will make the point threading itself quietly throughout that presentation, the point about walking with another. Here's a cool thing. The word ambassador, the roots of the word, is related to the word ambulate. Now, the portion of that word ambulate matters to me as a mama of a child with a traumatic brain injury. Not only was Carl's life saved because of an ambulance, but vis-a-vis the Synod's mission statement, Carl can't technically walk together with anyone. But he can ambulate. He could move. He can go about, which is the original meaning of the word. An ambassador is one who moves about, much like those tiny particles subatomically, with, though, a message, in our case, with the gospel, which we'll get to in a moment. We are called, you see, to be ambassadors of soteria, of health and healing and wholeness. Or, depending on the circumstances, we can follow my daughter Elsa's lead, who, as she was getting my son out of our car, where we talk about going on walk it rolls, so she was rolling Carl out of our van. We think it's actually pretty clever that I'm a pastor and I have a conversion van. Anyway, so we were pulling Carl out of our van, right? Getting ready to go march, to ambulate in a protest rally against a certain politician who came to town peddling hate and the separation of children from families and the stripping away of rights from women and GLBTQIA folk and of the very creation itself. And she said, "Mama, you know what we are today? And I said, nope, grinning and bracing myself. We are ambassadors of hope. I love that. And I love that girl. Ambassadors of hope. You see, when we ambulate, when we walk the talk we're walking, we are ambulating, of which we are being ambassadors, is this: Jesus is risen. Ali, that was pathetic. Jesus is risen. Which brings us to the end of the first presentation. But before I begin the second one, really, all evidence to the contrary, when I come to present, conversation is really important to me. And so I'm probably going to be chucking a bunch of information and thoughts your way for the, obviously, the first presentation and a little bit more, too, in the second. But I want to allow a little time now, knowing that incrementally there will be more after my next two thoughts or questions about the first presentation. As long as they don't involve math formulas. Any thoughts or questions? And if you don't have them now, you can ruminate on them. Can you make your way to the, if you do, make your way to a microphone? You do not have to have cards. I should have a card, however. Red.
Hi, I'm Kathy Cole from Resurrection in Shanahan. I was just wondering if your presentation would be online.
I can make it so.
That would be awesome.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other thoughts or questions? I'll move along then, and know that there will be other shots. This next presentation, this one where we are going to be dwelling with the second portion of the mission statement about knowing Christ, this is the only presentation of these three that I confess, and I warn Deaconess Cheryl, I give it or variations of it as often as I can. It's essentially my systematic theology in a nutshell. And to be very frank, I honestly do not care if you agree with it, though you'd all be better if you would, actually. But I do care that you understand what my framework is, because it grounds absolutely everything else that I think and say and do as a Christian. So for starters, I do not believe that there is any such thing as an atheist. That isn't to say that I don't understand what people mean by the term, namely someone who believes that there is no God, right? Or to say it differently, someone who doesn't believe in God. But at the end of the day, it is not at all clear what exactly is being denied. In what or in whom is one not believing? In his large catechism, Brother Martin Luther offers an assist in this explanation to the first commandment, "You shall have no other gods but me." He writes, "A god is the term for that to which we are to look for all good and in which we find refuge in all need. Therefore, to have a god is nothing else than to trust and to believe in that one with your whole heart. As I have often said, it is the trust and the faith of the heart alone that make both God and an idol." So what he's saying here, you see, is that our God, in short, is anything we trust more than anything else, which can be God, or it can turn out to be instead an idol. "If your faith and trust be right," he goes on, "then your God is the true one. Conversely, where your trust is false and wrong, there you do not have the true God. For these two belong together, faith and God. Anything on which your heart relies and depends, I say," he said, "that is really your God. Now, there's a lot going on there, a lot that we can see all the more clearly if we pay attention to just one word in that text, contextualized by two others that aren't in the text, and that we don't even use that very often. First is the word trust. If we trust in someone or something, we believe that the object of our trust deserves our commitment. Not gonna let us down, not gonna lead us astray, not gonna abandon us. The word, you see, isn't to be used lightly, because we trust only that which we believe is worthy of our trust. We mistrust that which isn't worthy of our trust, right? And so it seems simple. We sit on trust, the sturdy, albeit always internally moving and mostly built on empty space, chairs, and we avoid mistrust, the rickety ones. But the worthiness of something or someone isn't always so clear. In fact, it is more than just unclear. Sometimes the discernment of what or whom is the trustworthy one can be powerfully difficult. And to the rescue, then, come two quite uncommon words, the relevant ones that are not in Luther's text: penultimate and ultimate. Penultimate and ultimate. Now, although these aren't garden variety everyday terms, they're really actually indispensable for figuring out, in essence, our trust issues, and even for helping us figure out God. In Greek, words have accent marks on certain syllables, so it's a grammatical technique that helps determine the meaning, the declension, or the conjugation of any given word. English doesn't use accent marks in the same way that Greek does, so it makes it a little difficult for English speakers to understand what's going on with the ancient Greeks. A funny story from my days of teaching religion helped, I think, make the point, because the class had been studying the Apostle Paul and his references to different forms of love in Greek thought. And in the text were Greek words, agape, as in generous Christian love, right? Along with philia and eros, referring to brotherly love and erotic love. Later in the vocabulary section of the unit's exam, two different students, two of them, who sat on opposite sides of the room, wrote the definition of agape as mouth wide open. Coming around. Right? Spelled the same, but with a crucial phonetic difference of agape versus agape. Right. So accents, you see, matter. But who knows where to put them? Well, in Greek, it's by counting the syllables. So in Greek grammar, the last syllable of a word is called the ultimate syllable. So using the word syllable as our working example, bull is the ultimate syllable. The second to the last syllable of a word is the penultimate syllable. So in syllable, that would be la. So returning to Luther's definition of God, Luther didn't use the words penultimate and ultimate, but they rest behind his understanding of trust. Luther understood, you see, that in every single moment, we are trusting in something. And so as I wrote these presentations, I trusted that the chair I was sitting on would not break. I trust, for example, right now that I'll see my children again tomorrow on Saturday. I trust that my two hounds are not going to escape from their dog run. I trust even that tomorrow is going to come. However, the truth is, and certainly something the accident taught me, if I trust my entire life to any of these, I might discover myself being hurt if the chair's legs break, or fearful if my dogs go missing, or wrenched with impossible grief if something unspeakable happens to my son or my daughter, and even, perhaps, surprised right before existence stops. You see, it is terrifically easy to trust in something that is penultimate, immediately before the very last thing, instead of trust the thing that is indeed ultimate. There's nothing wrong, of course, with trusting one's chair, one's dog fence, one's children's well-being, and even tomorrow's arrival. But if our entire essence were dependent on these realities of always being true, and if for any reason they become not true, like with children, we have oftentimes said in our family, we haven't gotten our big one out of the way. It could happen again. Elsa, this silly thing called college is coming up. She's going to leave me one day, right? And if my entire essence were built up on my children being alive and with me, if for any reason that were to become not true, then not only would they have had weight of trust placed on them that was unfair, but also I would have learned that I had misplaced my ultimate trust in something that was finite. So we can see trust play out in any number of ways, both benign and nefarious. On the one hand, we can trust in love, we can trust that we have a job, we can trust in democracy. On the other, perhaps we trust in alcohol to numb us, in lying to protect ourselves, in gossip to entertain us, or in beauty to keep us ageless. Any objects of our trust, even the ones that seem to be good, could and often do let us down. Lovers die, employers downsize, and democracies are overthrown. Regardless, the point is this: at any given time, you see, we are trusting in something. We all have a God. Something receives our momentary commitment, and whatever that is becomes our God. It is the thing to which we say yes because we believe that it says yes to us. The question then isn't, you see, whether we have a God. The questions are, which God do we have, and is our God, in point of fact, ultimate or penultimate? And it matters. It matters because whatever we trust determines how we live. And so to circle back, you see, to Luther, we see that Luther, the former monk, right? Luther, the grounder, one can say, of our tradition here, Luther didn't define God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Instead, God, he said, is that to which we are to look for all good and in which we are to find refuge in all need. In other words, our God is that one above and beyond all others, in which or in whom we place our ultimate trust. And if you read closely, you'll notice that the first commandment makes it clear that even God knew that there are options. The commandment is, you shall have no other gods but me. Not, there aren't any gods but me. Because even God knew any number of ideas, material goods, or people can claim our allegiance and thereby become our God. For that reason, you see, there is no such thing as an atheist. Everybody trusts in something every moment. Again, the question isn't whether you believe in God. The question is rather, in which God or gods do you believe? I am absolutely convinced that these days at least two gods are competing for our collective trust: nationalism and its many sub-manifestations, and quietism. Both make a case for and a claim on our allegiance. Each draws on different motivations of institutional protectionism and self-protection. I am convinced that the primary issue facing the church these days is born out of this first commandment question: who or what is our God? And to complete the question in a way that really cannot be more Lutheran, what does it mean? That is to say, if we say we trust in something, we act accordingly, right? If I hadn't trust my chair, I wouldn't have sat in it. Because I did trust it, I was happily and presumably safely perched while I typed out these thoughts. I left my children with people whom I trust to not let them die while I'm gone. I have walked along our dog run, and I know that although on occasion the hounds might get stuck in the fence, they can't actually get out of the fence. And I've decided to err on the side of Luther and plant an apple tree, or in my case, tend to the apple trees we have, even though the world might indeed end tomorrow. Likewise, do you see, if we say that we trust in God, then we act accordingly. The radical question, radical meaning, actually rootedness, right? That's where we get the word radish, too, by the way. So the radical question, the deeply rooted question of our Christian identity being asked today of us Christians is this: what are the implications of trusting in God today in our context? Vis-a-vis the Synod, what does it actually mean to walk with Christ, and who do you mean by Christ? How do you understand Christ? And we're about to think through that together. In the summer of 2016, my two kids and I, we moved to Two Harbors, which again is just about 25 miles north of Duluth. My vocation as a freelance theologian allows us to plant our stakes most anywhere, and one day I asked Elsa Girl, who was then 13, where, if she could choose, our next home could be. And she first suggested, actually, well, she said, "Mama, guess what? We've got a map. We've got darts." Well, that's true, Elsa. I said, yes, we do. And that's pretty cool, but actually we're going to be more methodical about it all. And so she thought for a little bit, and she said, "Mama, I'd really love to be someplace where there's a lot of woods and a lot of water and a lot of hills." And I said, I think I know a spot. And so now we are up in northern Minnesota, as happy as can be. And though we've been there for about close to 3 years now, I still can't believe that I get to hear those foghorns of those freighters, and I get to watch them at the Two Harbors docks, gracefully navigating between breakwall and shore. And I get to see those enormous ships just off the bay when I pull out of our driveway and I hang a right. Elsa doesn't roll her eyes at me very often, but now she's fairly over my "hello, oar boat" greeting to these magnificent ships in the mornings when we leave for her school. In late 2016, I posted on my Facebook page two or three pictures of some of these tankers anchored just off of the Two Harbors docks. Enormous though they were, one could barely see them through this low, dense fog hovering over the bay. I wrote, and I grant it was a little over the top, "My Danish grandma called similar mists over the North Sea of Denmark heksebrew, namely witch's brew. And yesterday, Dad and I were indeed bewitched and really glad that instead of being on the deck of one of those frozen phantom-like tankers at the Two Harbors dock, we could hop right back into the heated seats of my Subaru and speed right on home to our stove." Well, not long after that, but long enough so that I didn't make the connection, a very odd message request showed up in my Facebook message inbox, and it was from a man whom I did not know, who asked simply, "So, have you ever been on an oar boat?" Which was creepy. But wanting to be charitable and also not a sheer idiot, I Googled his name before I replied to him. And I discovered that my now friend James was, of all things, once a Lutheran ELCA pastor. But he thought better of it, apparently, quit professional ministry, and instead became a first mate on one of those oar boats. And as luck and coincidence would have it, he and his wife are based in Duluth, and somehow my post had been marked public, so he had seen it, and it took him only a few nanoseconds after our meeting to suggest that perhaps my view of life on an oar boat was a bit romanticized. But after a couple of messages back and forth, James invited my daughter and me to tour his oar boat, the Roger Blau. And it was thrilling. These freighters are all the more impressive up front. One of the highlights of our tour was getting to see the taconite pellets from the Iron Range tumble out of the dock chutes and into the boat. And first the ore is loaded on one side, and then the tanker backs up and sails around to the other side of the dock, you see, at which point it's filled up with ore on the other side. And when the pellets spilled into the ship, James told Elsa and me to keep our eye on the five lights at the bow and the stern of the ship. The outer four are red, and the middle one is white. And if one or two of the red lights are lit on either side, back or front as well, it's an alert that the ship is listing, that is, it isn't evenly balanced. But when both white lights, bow and stern, are illuminated, the crew is assured that the cargo is equally distributed in all the bays. But until that happens, the mates holler out, "She's not trimmed to the white light." And as soon as James told me to listen for that phrase, I confess I punched him in the arm, burst out laughing, and I said, "That would be a great insult directed at me on most days." Folks, she's not trimmed to the white light. I am balanced. I am many things, but balanced is not one of them. And it's a small but real comfort to know that I am not alone. The fact is, I don't know many people who are perfectly balanced and don't have a metaphorical red light or two beaming out an alert on their bow, their stern, or both. Yet a myth, you see, that we hear all the time is that we are to live a balanced life. It's actually possible, says the nasty rumor, to be balanced. But the pursuit of living a balanced life is impossible because we are finite. We cannot attend to all the necessary claims life makes upon us. And sometimes the claims upon us, even the right and noble ones, compete or cause friction. For example, so that I could write these presentations, my son, to whom I'm committed above all as a mama, I had to sit beside me and play Angry Birds, mostly by himself, while I read and wrote. Now, my son deserved to have his mama play Angry Birds with him, and you deserve to have presentations. Both were true, but fulfilling both of them at the same time couldn't happen, at least not well. In related news, I am not simultaneously particle and wave. I am chronically, though, sheer chaos. From another angle, our faith calls us, you see, to certain ways of being in the world, ways that may run contrary to notions of patriotism or understandings of national loyalty that may also call to us. In either case, we have reason to feel imbalanced. The simultaneous call to vocation and to family responsibility tugs at me from opposite directions, and I am constantly listing. Likewise, we declare our allegiance to God, and yet feel some commitment, even pressure, to pledge our commitment also to the flag, a symbol that might represent values that in point of fact are inconsistent with God, and we might list. Under those circumstances, to use balance as a gauge might leave us feeling all the more imbalanced. I have come instead to appreciate the call to live an integrated life. I like the word integrated very much. It suggests that if you are integrated, you are aware of, you make use of, you respect all of the integers of your life. You live with, therefore, integrity in the sense of being complete and sound. When we live a well-integrated life, then, we acknowledge that what we are doing might look like we are not balanced and might indicate that we are not balanced, but we are, in fact, living with integrity. Interestingly, the Judeo-Christian tradition offers a faith word that corresponds quite nicely to the metaphor of being trimmed to the white light, while also helping us think about living with integrity. That word is righteousness. And the Hebrew word for righteous is tzedek. If we are tzedek, we act in keeping with God's ways and God's laws. But tzedek has another meaning too. The beloved late Lutheran theologian Joseph Sittler, also already mentioned, tells of his car breaking down in Israel. And when he went to pick it up from the repair shop, the mechanic declared that his vehicle was, of all things, again, tzedek. In this case, tzedek in Hebrew means to be properly aligned. The car's integrity had been compromised by some bumpy roads in Jerusalem, but once it had been realigned, it was again righteous. Every day, Christians, you see, are implicitly and explicitly asked these questions. To what should we be properly aligned? By what is our integrity threatened? How can we again and again be trimmed to the white light? In short, what is our God, and what does it mean to claim that one as our God? Christians claim that we understand God revealed through the gospel of Jesus. This is an answer to the question, to be sure. Despite our ready use, though, of the word gospel, there isn't actually a consensus about what the gospel means or implies. For example, it is often said that the gospel is that God loves us, or the gospel is the forgiveness of sins. And I think that both of these are true, right? I'm all about God loving us, and God knows I'm all about the forgiveness of sins. But thanks to my late mentor, Walt Bowman, I don't believe that either of these sayings are technically the gospel. They are both assertions. They are opinions. They are ideas. But in order to be believed, they require some historical grounding, some reason that one should commit to these notions as truth. So, for example, we could say that God is perhaps a banana, but such a statement kind of clamors for some substantial reason as to why we should throw our lives to a God in the form of a long, yellow, smushy fruit. The gospel has to be anchored in an event. We spoke about that in the first presentation. Even the Greek word for gospel, euangelion, makes the case. The prefix eu in euangelion, which is again the word that we translate as gospel, the prefix eu means good. Think, for example, of euthanasia, which means in the Greek, good death. Thanatos is death in Greek. Or euphemism, which means good speech. Or eulogy, a good word. And sometimes euphemisms are employed during eulogies. The second part of the word, angelion, might be easier for us to see straight away because it also serves as the root word for angel, which means messenger. So quite literally, you see, the word euangelion means good message, or as we might be more accustomed to hearing it, good news. I think sometimes we hear a term so often that it's awfully easy to forget its import. That, I think, is the case of the term good news, the English translation of the Greek word for gospel. The gospel is news, and it's good news. But news is something that happened, and furthermore, news is something that affects you. So this winter, the snow on my metal roof was melting at an alarmingly fast rate. And to anyone standing under the eaves, though, it was really cold, wet, heavy news that really super-duper affected, especially Carl, when the tremors of his wheelchair would shake the snow down. And yet, as newsy as it was then, it isn't news now. It's more a story. But Christians say the gospel is news that wasn't just news back in the day of Jesus and his first followers. No, Christians audaciously say that the gospel is still news. And it is good news at that. And while we love to tell the old, old story, we do still because it still affects us. It is a news story, so to speak. And so what then is this news? What is the good news? What is the gospel? The good news, the euangelion, the gospel, is that Jesus is risen. The dead guy, you see, did not stay dead as dead people are wont to do. That's it. That's the crux, so to speak, of the gospel. Resurrection, life out of death. And furthermore, Christians assert that the gospel, the good news, is not life just for Jesus. This resurrection wasn't just a personal triumph for him. No, resurrection means life out of death is offered to all people. The Christian gospel is news for all people, still even more than 2,000 years later. Because righteousness and gospel, another faith vocabulary word needs, besides righteousness and gospel, another faith vocabulary word needs reflection. And it's a common one used so freely that we might not even notice its internal power and significance. Christian. Isn't it interesting that although we speak of Jesus on a regular basis, although we say we believe in Jesus, although we say that Jesus died for our sins, we do not call ourselves Jesusians? Right? Instead, we refer to our religious faith and tradition as Christians, Christians. That's worth a linger. Do I still have time to linger? How are we doing? We're all right? Okay. So it matters, right, that we are Christians, Christians, and not Jesusians because we believe that Jesus is the Christ. And the word Christ matters. It flows off of our tongue so readily right after Jesus that we might even halfway think that Jesus, that Christ is Jesus' last name. As if Mary Christ and Joseph Christ had a sweet little swaddle baby named Jesus Christ, right? But that is not the case. Instead, the word Christ is a title. A title isn't something that one claims, but is something that is rather bestowed, such as the case of titles like hero, doctor, congresswoman, bishop when you're not paying attention, right? Yeah, I am. I wasn't talking about that. I was talking when you weren't expecting to be bishop. Not that, no, right. No. Christ is a title that informs the hearer that something is unique about this man named Jesus. He is a specific man named Jesus. But the Christ refers to something beyond. Jesus is the Christ because we believe that he is the Messiah. The word Christ, you see, comes from the Greek word Christos, and that word means anointed one, and is itself a translation of the Hebrew word Messiah or Messach. In other words, Messiah. The word Christ means Messiah. And we can easily miss the impact of this word Christ when even people who are not Christians refer to Jesus as the Christ. Like, for example, BC and AD, those terms don't mark Jesus' life as a man, but Jesus' role as Messiah. BC abbreviates before Christ, and AD abbreviates Anno Domini, which is Latin for the year of our Lord. And so referring to Jesus with the title Christ makes a faith claim about Jesus and about God, even when you don't mean to. For this reason, increasingly, people are talking about BCE, before the Common Era, and CE, the Common Era. And so for this reason, and I won't give all of the texts here just to save some time, but trust me on this, and if you're curious, I can give you the text later, that Jesus was called the Christ primarily after the early Christian community believed that he was risen. And that is crucial because it indicates that his resurrection confirmed belief among the early believers that Jesus was, in fact, the Messiah. Right? It was only then that they began to pray to him, to heal in his name, to baptize in his name, to sing hymns to him, and address him as God after the event of the resurrection. Because despite the general tendency for dead people to stay dead, Jesus didn't. The early believers determined that his resurrection, you see, was euangelion, was good news, was the gospel. Moreover, they believed that the resurrection confirmed that what Jesus was up to is what God is up to. That is, and this is crucial, they were convinced that Jesus' agenda reflects God's agenda. And so what if the one who was raised, who had been raised, had mocked and belittled, excluded and assaulted, created barriers between people, and dealt in the ways of hate and bullying and death? If that sort of leader had been raised, we would likely be obligated to endorse that leader as a sign of the reign of God. But we Christians, have a very different expression of God's will and a very different notion of who God is and what God's agenda is. Because Jesus the Christ engaged in activities instead like healing and feeding, welcoming all people, teaching all people, extending, even breaking boundaries, drinking good wine, eating good food, and of course, forgiving. It's a critical, if obvious, distinction, you see. The resurrection confirms that Jesus' agenda was God's agenda, and so it simultaneously reveals who God is, and it simultaneously reminds us of who we, too, are to be, if we call ourselves Christians. And this returns us to my opening story about touring this freighter and my metaphor of being trimmed to the white light, being properly balanced. Because spiritually speaking, the light to which we are to be trimmed shines from the empty tomb, and it sheds light onto Jesus' life and ministry, not just as an example, but as the very expression of God's will for the sake of the world. That light, you see, illuminates the way of those who identify as followers of God and as Christians, what our ultimate trust is to be. And so here, then, is an opportunity to ask this very Lutheran question. What does this euangelion, this good news, this resurrection event mean to us as individuals, as members of the church, and as those who are called to let the light shine in the world? And I think the best response to this question I have yet heard comes from my late mentor, Walt Bowman, who said, "Now that you know that death does not win, there is more to do with your lives than preserve them." And I am going to say that again. Now that you know that death doesn't win, there is more to do with your lives than preserve them. Bowman, you see, is referring to this radical freedom that this euangelion, this good news, this resurrection offers us. The truth is, we can readily imagine any number of motivations to preserve our lives, for any number of reasons could explain why we are afraid we might need to preserve our lives. A handful: the possibility of being attacked, of being alone, of being exposed, of being ill, of being mortal, of being vulnerable, of being in love, of not being in love, of being a single parent, of being gifted, of being decidedly not gifted in one coveted way or another. And in addition, there are the risks of losing our reputation, of losing our families, of losing our privilege. And if any of these were to come to pass, it would be a death of some sort, right? It's a way not to offer a pass on privileged people clinging to their often racially and economically stacked status, rank, and class, but to find a way to compassion at their fear of losing it, mitigating then a return of hostility and hate. Because you see, I believe that even the New Testament writers understood the truth that we see reasons to fear. Particularly in the Gospel of Luke, we hear prophets and angels and Jesus himself announcing that we don't need to be afraid. But implicit, you see, is that that reassurance wouldn't be needed if people weren't afraid in the first place and had reason to be so. But Jesus' resurrection reminds us that death does not have the last word. As I have often come to say, the gospel promises us that death is real, but life is realer. And it is into this sort of promise that we are baptized, right? We are immersed into the promise that nothing, not even fear and not even death, is more powerful than God's love for us. And interestingly, while the primary theological motivation for baptizing babies is an assertion of grace, God's love is pure gift, simply by being alive, we are worthy of receiving grace, sometimes people still baptize out of fear of death. Emergency baptisms, for example, sometimes take place to stave off the possibility of damnation in case the baby's death before the child were baptized. sometimes you see even the sacrament of baptism can represent our fear, not least of all our fear of judgment and death, rather than our trust in a living, grace-filled God. But left, you see, only with the act of baptism, without knowledge either of the event or practice of it in a community that nurtures the life lived out of it, we have essentially only a really lovely piece of paper taped to our back, one that we can't see, but that God can. It says, baptized. But if we belong to a community, or if we are in a family that knows and embraces our baptism, then that piece of paper you see is brought from behind our back and is taped to our fronts, smack dab on our foreheads. Because not only do we see the promise of our baptism in the image of our own faces, but through that community, we also see it in those around us. We are reminded individually and collectively that we are baptized, you see, into the death and the resurrection, into the euangelion, into the good news of Jesus not being dead. How are we doing on time? Still okay? All right. You guys still okay? All right. In our family, we have morning blessings and evening blessings. And our blessings just before the children fall asleep go like this, sweet one, are you comfy? And are you cozy? And are you content? And do you know that you are loved? And then when we finally get through the questions and these answers, we'll say together, after they let me know that they are loved, well, that is the most important thing. And then I move into the second and final ritual with Carl and Elsa. It's especially important to me because I began it when Carl was struggling in the intensive care unit after the traumatic brain injury. And I say to him, sweet child, both of them, sweet child, you are beautiful and you are safe and I love you. And then I make the sign of the cross in their foreheads. And when I do, I say, and so does God. It is crucial to me to know that my children know that they are, no matter what, loved. And I want them to realize that just as their grandfather and father made the sign of the cross on their foreheads when they were baptized and had it made on their foreheads too, decades and decades before, so it can be made on their foreheads every single day that I am blessed to put it right there, reminding them that they are ultimately claimed by the Father and by the Son and by the Holy Spirit, because everything else is penultimate. Because you see, as Walt Bowman taught us, baptism only works if it is used. Baptism only works if it is trusted. Our God is that in which or in whom we trust. And baptism initiates us into a life of trust in God, or our participation in the community of God, into the risen Jesus. And the word community is key here, for baptism is not just an individual matter. It is, of course, a promise to each individual person. We are known by name. But baptism initiates us for the community of the baptized. We are, in a sense, baptized into a community of trusters. And this is good news that radiates out of good news. We don't go at it alone. We live and we worship with people who collectively commit their lives to the notion that life is more powerful than death, who make the conscious decision to not trust fear, who believe that because Jesus is risen, we will live as people claimed by the resurrection promise. Because now that we know that death does not win, that there is more to do with our lives than preserve them. There's more to that, but we're going to, I think, stop now if we have some time for questions, and then we can move forward if there's time. Otherwise, we'll wait till tomorrow. Questions or comments? Pushback is welcome. Yes, sir.
I'm thinking about ambulating. When my wife and I go out to walk, no matter how hard I try, she's always ahead of me. I'm thinking about walking with Jesus, walking with Christ, ambulating, you know, the Spirit and everything. It seems to me that sometimes we will be walking side by side, but sometimes one of us is ahead and one of us is behind. Any comment on that?
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Anna, could you summarize what he just said?
Yes.
I had trouble hearing him.
So he was saying that when he and his wife go out for a walk, when they ambulate, she leaves him in the dust. That's a paraphrase. And so he's wondering whether or not there might be an analogy for different paces of, in essence, walking with Jesus. Is that more or less a fair summary? Fair enough. That's good. I'll live with that. So you're bringing up a question that is awfully helpful for any number of reasons, not least of all because of the resolution that this assembly just passed about the 50th anniversary. Makes me so emotional. That's awesome, by the way. But right, so let's be clear. 50 years ago, that decision to ordain women wasn't made because a bunch of stodgy, all-male, systematic theologians gathered together in some closet with a bunch of brandy and revisited the matter, right? What was going on in the 70s in the streets? Bras were being burned, right? Right? And so had this notion that women should be ordained just popped up right then? No. Like, the women at the tomb, I saw this quote right around Easter time, this meme going around on Facebook with the women having told the men, and the men said, "Thanks a lot, girls, we've got it, we'll take it from here." Right, and so I can't help but think that not just then, but even yet now, it is possible that the Spirit is annoyed with the church and is moving out into the streets, right? I think that sometimes the Spirit is pulling us. Process theology would be about that too, by the way, right? But that the Spirit is not contained by the church or the constitution of the church or the, right? It's wild and untamed. Annie Dillard, by the way, has this wonderful piece. I should find it. If I don't find it, maybe somebody else can look it up because I'm a bird. But she has this gorgeous piece where she writes about being in her church service, and everybody was just kind of calm and collective and had on their pretty hats, and she's like, "Sweet Jesus, we need helmets. Like, the Holy Spirit is on the loose, people, right?" And in fact, it wasn't too long ago when there was actually a child right before the children's sermon who donned a helmet and walked up to the children's sermon. Like, "Holy sweet Jesus, what's happening now? Maybe the kid knows something I don't." Right? But that part of it is that the Spirit is pulling us, I think, in different ways. As an aside, one of my more recent favorite books is a book that is not a theology book, but is relevant, I think, to the church these days, and it's called Trickster Makes the World, and it's by a guy named Lewis Hyde, and he looks at all of these wonderful traditions, mythological traditions, where there's tricksters, the fox or Loki, right? Or even the salmon, and they're not malevolent trickster figures, but they sometimes cause disarray, right? And even some harm, even though that isn't their intention, ultimately. And I kind of think that's sort of how the Holy Spirit works, right? Whenever there is change, it makes us uncomfortable, but it could be that the trickster is at work. So there's that piece. I think another element that I would want to note, too, is that I am very, I don't know quite the order in which I want to say this. I think it's absolutely important for us in the church to be, pastoral and kind and walk with people until they're ready to hear certain things or to be confronted with possibilities of change. One of my fun stories from serving as a pastor in Badger was of Lily, who came to the weekly Bible study. They'd asked me to cover the origin of the Bible, right? And every single Sunday for a long period of time. And we got into the New Testament, Mark, and every single Sunday, Lily, who was just beginning with a little bit of Alzheimer's, she would say multiple times, "Pastor Anna, I was just told, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved." And no matter how many times she said it, the people assembled there thanked her for her contribution. But on this particular Sunday, I totally misjudged and began to suggest that possibly some things in the Bible weren't literally true, that there was poetry and metaphor. And it really agitated Lily until finally she slammed down her hand. All the heads went whoomp right to Lily, right? And Lily said, "Pastor Anna, is this gonna screw me up?" She said, "I'm almost dead and I don't need nothing to screw me up." So, of course, all those heads went whoop. And I pulled out the only thing I had. "Just believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved," right? And so here's the perplexing thing, because you don't want to screw people up, and yet the gospel screws people up. Like, dead people are supposed to stay dead. Particles are supposed to be particles and waves are supposed to be waves, all right? And so there's, what was the word that you put in your report, nimble? That there's a nimbleness to be attentive, to walk with people. But at the same time, the next and last response is that I am deeply concerned about the bifurcation of the word pastoral and prophetic. I think it's a toxic dichotomy, because I think when we say pastoral, it's code for being nice and not causing conflict. But what that actually does, as often as not, is enable oppression and harm. So that it might offend the people in the pews, but it might free the people who aren't in the pews to come in, right? And so so there is this intuition about not alienating people, and yet at the same time, not enabling people, and encouraging people to see that the Holy Spirit is on the loose, and it's time for seatbelts and helmets. Does that sort of work?
Yeah, you said some of what I would have said a little further. You say it much better. The pastoral and the prophetic are different kinds of walks,
mm-hmm.
But maybe they aren't.
Yeah.
I wonder about Jesus as the Marine Corps drill instructor, that kind of walk to learn. That's very crude, but, you know, there's something about, if Jesus is the ultimate love of my life and the ultimate direction where my love and everything else is to be directed, there are demands with that.
Right. One of the things I, you'll probably, if I can actually get through all my presentations, which is my fault, I put too much in, but I think Lutherans need to reclaim James. Luther didn't like James. I kind of do, a lot. I think it would do us good to understand that if we say that we are Christians, then it means that we align ourselves, we pledge allegiance to Christ, and therefore Christ's agenda, right? That it really is important to note that Jesus is the one whom we call Christ, not Mussolini, Hitler, Trump. Those agendas are not of Jesus. They're not. And so what does that mean is the Lutheran question, right? When we say that we are Christians, it means something. And I think it's hard to really picture the radicality of that faith claim, that identification, that audacity of naming ourselves as Christians, because when we really grasp it, it transforms everything, including, I mean, a couple of, do I have time for two quick metaphors?
You've got 4 minutes.
I can do it. Quick metaphors, movies, Matrix. The Matrix is a great movie for talking about this. So those of you who know The Matrix, there's a man named Neo. Like, it's not like they couldn't have bludgeoned us anymore over the heads with the hints about the names, but Neo, right? And he had this inclination that the reality he was in wasn't actually the reality, that it was a programmed reality, that he was part of a program. And as it turns out, the programmers caught on to this, that he'd figured them out. But so did the other people who had already figured out, the good guys in a sense, that they were living in a program. So it was in a sense a race to get his allegiance, right? And so he was invited then to make a decision by the good guys. You either, what was it, the red pill and the green pill? I can't ever remember the colors. But one pill would allow him to forget the conversation that he was actually onto something. The other pill he would have to pop, and if he did, he would leave this foreign reality, this fake reality, and immerse himself into a new reality, the truer reality. He opted for that. And it was unpleasant, right? To be ripped out of that context that he had presumed to be true until recently was painful and wrenching. It's a terrible scene, especially for a wimp like me. But it's also a metaphor for what it's like when you realize that you've been trusting in something that isn't worth your trust, because it forces you to change fundamentally everything. Everything you thought you could trust, you can't anymore. And you're encouraged and invited and compelled to trust something else. Another movie that's great is The Field of Dreams. Can a person ever watch that movie too many times? No. And so in The Field of Dreams, you've got Ray, who hears this voice, right? He's on the verge of bankruptcy. And the voice essentially encourages him, nudges him, lures him to plow under his cornfield. As he goes to the feed store, of course, what do you hear in the soundtrack? But crazy, right? It's this wonderful little image that the guy is not thinking clearly, because nobody in their right mind would do that. But not only did he do that, but then he saw the dead guys, right? And guess what? His wife saw the dead guys, and his daughter saw the dead guys, and the next thing you know, he's going off to find authors, and he comes back with more dead guys, and they're all on the field. And increasingly, the people who are in that, who can't see the dead guys, think he's nuts, right? By the end of the movie, who's not thinking clearly? The people who can't see the dead guys. Christians, we are called to live like we see the dead guy, right? It's crazy. And it forces us to make decisions and to take stands that are not popular. But they're faithful, they're righteous, and they are trimmed to the white light. Okay, thank you.
So this is the 32nd annual assembly that I've been a part of, and the first one we've ever encountered burning bras. Something I'm going to have to give a lot of thought to is what you said, the Spirit is annoyed with the church. I think that's true. I think we should work on that. So, Anna, thank you for ambulating with us thus far, and we look forward to hearing from you again.